Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Imagining the Kingdom, How Worship Works, by James K. A. Smith, narrated by Lyle Blaker.
These beauteous forms, through a long absence, have not been to me as is a landscape to a blind man's eye, but oft, in lonely rooms, and mid the din of towns and cities, I have owed to them, in hours of weariness, sensations sweet, felt in the blood, and felt along the heart, and passing even into my purer mind with tranquil restoration. Feelings, too, of unremembered pleasure, such, perhaps, as have no slight or trivial influence on that best portion of a good man's life, his little, nameless, unremembered acts of kindness and of love. Nor less, I trust, to them I may have owed another gift, of aspect more sublime, that blessed mood in which the burthen of the mystery, in which the heavy and the weary weight of all this unintelligible world is lightened, that serene and blessed mood in which the affections gently lead us on, until the breath of this corporeal frame and even the motion of our human blood almost suspended, we are laid asleep in body and become a living soul, while with an eye made quiet by the power of harmony and the deep power of joy, we see into the life of things. William Wordsworth, from Lines Composed a Few Miles Above Tintern Abbey, 1798.
Preface. Novelists often attest that their characters take on a life of their own. So while the writer begins with a plan, a storyline, character sketches, a sense of the ending to which all of it is headed, the creative process is full of surprises. Not until the novelist is mired in the mess of production could she have known that the protagonist should go there, should meet him, should say that. Creators are not masters of the universe they create. They, too, are recipients of that world and need to follow the path on which they are taken, even if they might have invented it to begin with. In my preface to Desiring the Kingdom, I sketched a program for the Cultural Liturgies trilogy in which volumes 2 and 3 would be scholarly monographs aimed at a narrower, more specialized audience of scholars. The idea was for Volume 1 to provide an accessible overview of the model and argument, and then for Volumes 2 and 3 to be narrow, deep explorations of particular aspects of the argument, philosophical anthropology in Volume 2 and politics in Volume 3. In the 3 years since I completed Desiring the Kingdom, during which I have had a number of opportunities to share and discuss my core argument with a wide range of audiences, I have decided to revise that original plan for a couple of related reasons. First, as it turns out, Desiring the Kingdom was not as accessible as I thought it was. While that first volume may have seemed to me like a relatively popular sketch, as is often the case, scholars are not very good judges at what counts as accessibility. Many of the readers of Desiring the Kingdom perceived it as a challenging academic book, though obviously scholarly colleagues in philosophy and theology saw it differently. A bit whimsical in places, a little imprecise in others. Such is the fate of a hybrid book. Too many footnotes and references to German philosophers to qualify as popular, not enough footnotes and too many creative asides to be properly academic. Nonetheless, I've decided to live in that between space, to inhabit that hybridity, and ultimately to continue in that vein for all of the volumes of the Cultural Liturgies trilogy. I recognize that there is a sense in which Desiring the Kingdom is a hypocritical book, or at least a book at risk of performative contradiction. On the one hand, the book argues that we are primarily, and at root, affective animals, whose worlds are made more by the imagination than by the intellect. That humans are those desiring creatures who live off of stories, narratives, images, and the stuff of poiesis. On the other hand, the book tries to make this case in a didactic way, on a theoretical register, articulating a philosophical anthropology. Desiring the Kingdom recognized the limits of such a project and tried to navigate its internal tensions by including a number of forays into the arts and literature, with long digressions in which all of this is pictured in novels, films, and poetry. But still, while it might seem ludicrous to even breathe about this in the same sentence with Marcel Proust, I was intrigued to discover that the young Proust faced a similar challenge. In one of his earliest writing projects, before A la recherche du temps perdu, In Search of Lost Time, Proust was up against a similar challenge in terms of genre, working in the cracks between them. In his notebooks around the time he was working on the manuscript that we now know as Contre Sainte Beuve, Proust would write, "Should I make it a novel or a philosophical study? Am I a novelist?" While it is hard for us to imagine him as anything but a novelist, indeed, Proust is perhaps the quintessential novelist, it's interesting to see Proust's vacillation in this regard. He was a writer in search of a form. The themes of Contre Sainte Beuve show us why, since the work opens with a jarring claim. Every day I set less store on intellect. Proust's particular concern is the limits of intellect with respect to memory, a theme that would dominate In Search of Lost Time. On this account, intellectual reconstructions of the past strip the past of its irreducible poetry. So honoring the past and the uniqueness of memory requires something different, something other than a didactic rehearsal of past facts. But here, Proust runs up against an irony and a tension. Perhaps it will cause surprise that I, who make light of the intellect, should have devoted the following few pages precisely to some of those considerations that intellect, in contradiction to the platitudes that we hear said or read in books, suggests to us. At a time when my days may be numbered, and besides, are we not all in the same case, it is perhaps very frivolous of me to undertake an intellectual exercise. But if the truths of intellect are less precious than those secrets of feeling that I was talking about just now, yet, in one way, they too have their interest. Thus, the reflective artist finds himself in this bind. But perhaps in the course of these pages we may be led, Proust hopes, to realize that it touches on very important intellectual problems and on what is perhaps for an artist the greatest of all, this relative inferiority of the intellect which I spoke of at the beginning. Yet all the same, it is intellect we must call on to establish this inferiority. Desiring the Kingdom found itself in a similar jam, putting me in the strange position of making a philosophical argument for relativizing the importance of the intellect, a theoretical argument for delimiting the role of the theoretical attitude. But again, Proust owns up to a productive catch-22 in this regard. If intellect does not deserve the crown of crowns, only intellect is able to award it. And if intellect only ranks second in the hierarchy of virtues, intellect alone is able to proclaim that the first place must be given to instinct. Proust ultimately resolved this tension by writing a novel. While I hope such a project might be in my future, it is not the task of this book. Nonetheless, I do feel compelled to write this volume and the next in a way that is consistent with the central argument of cultural liturgies, and in a form that at least somewhat attests to the centrality of the imagination in my model and argument. As a small gesture in this direction, I have decided to retain the voice and format of Desiring the Kingdom for volumes 2 and 3. Thus, the listener will continue to find exercises that attempt to picture the argument through engagements with literature, film, and poetry. And I have tried generally to retain a voice that has a little more verve than one usually hears in the dreaded scholarly monograph. The second reason for revising the original plan, not consigning volumes 2 and 3 to the narrow irrelevance of scholarly monographs, is simply that there are wider audiences who are now looking for the sequel or sequels to Desiring the Kingdom. So retooling the plan for this volume and the subsequent third volume is largely a matter of gratitude. Desiring the Kingdom found friends in places I wouldn't have anticipated.
While it has been widely discussed in Christian higher education and regions of the Theological Academy, I am also grateful that my argument and model have been enthusiastically received by pastors, worship leaders, artists, and Christian educators at the K-12 level. Conversations with these audiences over the past few years have honed my instincts and helped me refine my argument in ways I otherwise would not have. These readers and conversation partners have also helped me to see just how and where the argument of desiring the kingdom hits the ground in ecclesial and pedagogical practice. Indeed, these practitioners are often able to concretize the argument in ways that I cannot. So out of gratitude, and in hopes of keeping them in the conversation, I have decided to retain the format and voice of Volume 1 for the entire trilogy. Because of this, I've provided a brief how-to for listeners from different audiences, with the hope of providing an angle of entry for each. How to listen to this book. Like Desiring the Kingdom, this book is something of a hybrid, pitched between the academy and the church, since its argument is aimed at both. That means, of course, that it's also doomed to fall between the cracks and end up disappointing both, too scholastic for practitioners and too colloquial for scholars. I've decided that I'm willing to risk the ire of both in order to not give up on either. But given that this will pose different challenges for different listeners, permit me to offer a little instructional guide for different, though related, audiences. For practitioners, the ultimate telos of the Cultural Liturgies Project is the renewal of practice. So in many ways, practitioners are my ultimate audience. You are Christian educators, pastors, worship leaders, campus ministers, and those involved in worship arts. You are reflective about your ministry and teaching and are open to new models and metaphors and theories. But you are not looking for theory for theory's sake. So in some ways, this book asks a lot of you. In particular, the first half of the book asks you to wade through expositions of French theorists, Merleau-Ponty and Bourdieu, while I lay the foundations for a liturgical anthropology. I can completely understand if you find yourself at times impatient in this section of the book. However, I do believe the heavy lifting in Part 1 is essential for the more tangible discussion in Part 2. You might look at Part 1 as digging a theoretical well from which we'll then drink in Part 2. Or think of Part 1 as furnishing a theoretical toolbox for reconsidering and reappreciating the how and the why of worship and liturgical formation, and more generally, the implications for Christian education and Christian formation. Both Maurice Merleau-Ponty and Pierre Bourdieu offer theoretical models of habituation and formation that are suggestive, provocative, and at some points poetic. Rather than simply plunder them for juicy quotes, I have provided an exposition of their work that develops the context and big picture of their proposals, which should help you see just how and why I think their work has implications for a vision of Christian formation and education. But feel free to skip the footnotes. I have tried to do a couple of things to help earn your patience in Part 1. First, at various points, I have paused to raise some questions about the implications of Merleau-Ponty and Bourdieu for how we think about the practices of Christian worship. I hope you'll find these to be little rest stops on a long road of theoretical reflection, contemplative pauses for thinking about how a phenomenology of embodiment begins to hit the ground for worship planning and liturgical formation. Consider them promissory notes that are then more fully explored in Part 2. Second, I have continued to employ various creative asides to help illustrate their arguments and theories, drawing on film and literature. I hope these are interspersed such that just as your eyes begin to glaze over from absorbing the intricacies of phenomenology, you'll hit upon a reflection on Rise of the Planet of the Apes that refreshes your energy and attention. Part 2 should then be your section of the book, the place where we'll explore the specific implications of a liturgical anthropology for an understanding of Christian worship and formation. Granted, Part 2 is no how-to manual. While I hope it hews closer to practical concerns, it does so in a reflective mode and with big picture concerns in mind. My goal in Part 2 is to suggest how the philosophical analyses of being in the world in Part 1 reframes how we look at matters of formation and generate a new appreciation of how worship works. This should encourage a new kind of critical concern about the force and formative power of secular liturgies. But it should also encourage a new intentionality about Christian worship and worship planning. In turn, it should generate new intentionality about the shape of a distinctly Christian pedagogy in education. In both cases, I hope the argument and analyses of imagining the kingdom provide further depth and nuance to the central argument of desiring the kingdom. For scholars, this book is decidedly not a scholarly monograph, because of both its tone and its telos, which is ultimately the renewal of Christian practice. Nonetheless, I do think embedded in here are some original, constructive proposals that might advance conversations in philosophy of religion. Indeed, implicit in my argument is a research agenda for both philosophy of religion and sociology of religion. In particular, I would invite scholars to listen to my engagement with Merleau-Ponty as a foray into the continuing conversation between French phenomenology and philosophy of religion. That conversation, which is drawn on the work of Emmanuel Levinas, Jacques Derrida, Jean-Luc Marion, and others, has largely been a philosophy of God, concerned with themes of revelation, alterity, transcendence, appearance, and so forth. This is a robust and important trajectory of research. However, it has not fostered a phenomenology of religion, a phenomenological analysis of religious practice. I hope the model sketched here contributes to a growing conversation at the intersection of philosophy and liturgy, perhaps even to the emergence of a philosophy of liturgy. The liturgical anthropology sketched here also has implications for the social sciences, particularly social scientific accounts of religion and religious phenomena. Some of the arguments and analyses here in Imagining the Kingdom could have been distilled in scholarly articles for relevant journals in the Guild, and I may still pursue some trajectories of research in more specialized conversations. But for now, I have chosen to embed the scholarly proposals in this hybrid book. So to my scholarly colleagues, I ask for your patience with some of the asides that follow. I'd ask you to remember that, at points, I have had to forego some qualifications and nuance for the sake of a wider audience. Significant literatures that I have engaged do not appear in the footnotes, including, no doubt, some works you consider essential. I'd like to invite you to listen to this book as a phenomenological exercise in returning to the things themselves, and ask that you evaluate the argument on the basis of what it says rather than what it leaves out. Introduction. A Sentimental Education. On Christian Action. Following Calvin, then, Protestants may insist that ecclesial practices have nothing to do with affecting human justification, everything to do with human sanctification, and, most important, everything to do with divine agency and power. Picturing the end of worship. As a child, he couldn't wait for church to be over. The beginning of worship was, for Andrew, merely a T-minus 60 countdown to the end. Indeed, more than once, Walter Mitty-like, he launched into his own reverie as the pastor summoned the congregation with the call to worship. The old, tired formulas of the pastor. The psalmist reminds us of our purpose, calling us to worship, would be replaced in Andrew's imagination with the crackly static of rocket launch transmissions that seemed to be conducted inside tin cans. Apollo, where all systems go, over. Roger that, Houston. All systems operational. We are go for launch, over. T-minus 3 minutes to launch. Firing main engines, over. Roger that, Houston. We are all systems go, over. T-minus 1 minute to launch. Stand by for ignition. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have ignition. We have liftoff.
If he was lucky, Andrew would emerge from his NASA fantasy around the time of the offering. All too often, he came back to Earth just before the moment of confession, which meant he was still T-minus 45 till the end.
Ugh.
The bulletin would then become a checklist, a way to mark the droning passage of time. Confession? Check. Assurance of pardon? Check. Reading of the law? Check. Creed? Check. Pastoral prayer and prayers of the people? Long wait to be able to check that off, as an elder seems to be praying for the entire world. Bible reading? Check. Sermon? Wait for it. Wait for it. Still waiting. Finally, check. We're getting close. Offering. Check. Wait, second offering for benevolence?
Ugh.
Check. Finally. Doxology. We're getting tantalizingly close now. Check. Another prayer. Check. Andrew can now taste it. A hymn. 7 verses. Finally. Check. Here we are. The finish line. T minus 30 seconds. Everyone stands. The end of worship is in sight. Benediction? Yes! Freedom! Andrew now smirks to himself as he recognizes that caged eagerness in his own 8-year-old daughter, Elizabeth, who practically catapults over him to reach the cookies and juice downstairs. But he himself sees the end of worship very differently now. Far from seeing it as the bursting moment of release into some unfettered freedom, Andrew now realizes that the end of worship is a sending, that the blessing at the conclusion of worship is also a commissioning, and that the end of worship, in terms of its telos and goal, is bound up with what they'll do next. Head out of the door, into the world. We are not released at the conclusion of worship, Andrew thinks to himself. We are not merely free to go, dismissed from some appointment or event. Having been drawn into the life of the triune God through our union with Christ, we are sent. The end of Christian worship comes with a responsibility. Like all those prophetic encounters with the living God, this encounter with the triune God sends one away with a commission and a charge. Go and do in the power of the Spirit as a witness to the risen Christ, inviting your neighbors to become citizens of the coming kingdom. What we've just done in worship is both a rehearsal of the entire history of the world and a rehearsal for kingdom come. The end of Christian worship brings us back to the beginning of creation, to our commissioning in the garden and our deputizing as God's image bearers, those responsible for tending and tilling God's good but now broken creation. The end of worship, Andrew now realizes, is the end of worship. The culmination of Christian worship is its sending ending. In this time of already not yet, the end and goal and telos of worship is being sent from this transformational encounter as God's witnesses and image bearers. Christian worship is not some religious silo for our private refueling that replenishes our inner life. It is not merely some duty we observe in order to keep our eternal ducks in a row. Nor is it some special sequestered experience that fills up a religious compartment in our souls, unhooked from what we do in the world Monday through Friday. Worship isn't a weekly retreat from reality into some escapist enclave. It is our induction into the real world. Worship is the space in which we learn to take the right things for granted precisely so we can bear witness to the world that is to come, and in the power of the Spirit's transformation, labor to make and remake God's world in accord with His desires for creation. We could never hope to entertain such a commission without the empowering work of the Spirit who tangibly meets us in worship. This is why Andrew sees Elizabeth's eagerness for worship to end, and remembers his own youthful eagerness for the same, as an understandable naivete about the burdens of this encounter. In contrast to Elizabeth's sense of sheer liberation from the doldrums, Andrew now experiences the end of worship with a certain sanctified ambivalence, a sort of holy ambiguity. On the one hand, he hungrily receives the gracious announcement of blessing. On the other hand, he senses the responsibility of the commission. This is no cheap grace.
This is a space of spirit-filled transformation for the sake of being sent, to go and make disciples, to be witnesses to Jerusalem and Samaria and to the ends of the earth, to take up once again our creational mandate to be God's image-bearers by being culture-makers. When worship ends on Sunday, it spills over into our cultural labor on Monday. And Andrew's only hope and prayer is that by the grace of God and the power of the Spirit, everything that has preceded this sending has, over time, empowered him to be the witness he's sent to be. The end of Christian education and the end of worship. Or, the end of Christian education as the end of worship. The renewal of the church and the Christian university, a renewal of both Christian worship and Christian education, hinges on an understanding of human beings as liturgical animals, creatures who can't not worship, and who are fundamentally formed by worship practices. The reason such liturgies are so formative is precisely because it is these liturgies, whether Christian or secular, that shape what we love. And we are what we love. The reason for articulating this model of the human person is ultimately to provide an adequate account of Christian action. This begins with grinding a new lens for cultural analysis. Such a liturgical anthropology recalibrates cultural analysis and critique by recognizing the deformative and transformative power of practices, communal, embodied rhythms, rituals, and routines that over time quietly and unconsciously prime and shape our desires and most fundamental longings. And it is recognition of this formative power of liturgical practices that then drives my constructive concern to encourage intentionality about Christian liturgical formation in two key institutions, the church and the Christian university. Not because these are the only institutions that matter, but because they are unique sites for intentional Christian formation and because they both exist for sending. Students leave a school via commencement, and worshipers leave worship with a blessing and charge, sent into the world for the world. In both cases, we are sent from formation for mission. The focus on the church and the university is strategic, not exclusive. Both are crucial institutions in the Missio Dei. A Christian university is a hybrid institution. It is simultaneously embedded in two quite different ecosystems. On the one hand, the Christian university is a university, an institution of higher education that is part of a network of colleges and universities engaged in teaching and research. Much of the shape and life of a Christian university reflects this wider sense of what higher education should look like. And accreditation agencies reinforce this aspect of our ecological situation. On the other hand, a Christian university is a Christian institution, which situates it in the ecosystem of the church and various other institutions of Christian mission. So the Christian university is located at the intersection of at least these two ecosystems. And it is precisely this hybridity that generates the unique mission and task of Christian higher education. This is why, in Desiring the Kingdom, I argued that the mission of the Christian university should be conceived not just in terms of dissemination of information, but also, and more fundamentally, as an exercise in formation. The Christian university does not simply deposit ideas into mind receptacles, thereby providing just enough education to enable credentialing for a job. No. The Christian university offers an education that is formative, a holistic education that not only provides knowledge, but also shapes our fundamental orientation to the world. It is what I'll call, in a slight tweak of Flaubert, a sentimental education. The alumni of Christian universities are sent into God's good but broken world, equipped with new intellectual reservoirs and skills for thinking. But ideally, they are also sent out from the Christian university with new habits and desires and virtues. They will have been habituated to love God and His kingdom, to love God and desire what He wants for creation, and thus engage the world. Indeed, If we are going to teach students rigorously and critically, we must also form them in what Augustine calls the right order of love. In other words, the end, telos, of Christian education is action. The Christian university is a place from which students are sent as ambassadors of the coming kingdom of God. They are commissioned to undertake cultural labor that is redemptive and reconciling, reflecting Christ's work of reconciliation. It is in this way that Christian colleges are caught up in the Missio Dei. The alumni of Christian universities are primed and shaped to take up our task as God's image bearers, cultivating God's good creation, working to renew a fallen world, bearing witness to how the world can be otherwise, bearing fresh olives to a world battered by the floodwaters of injustice. We aren't just educating spectators or observers. We are educating actors. What Andy Crouch, echoing a long Reformed tradition, describes as culture makers. This end, telos, of Christian education in action is exactly the same as the end of Christian worship, because both are expressions of mission. What happens at the end of historic Christian worship is a benediction, a blessing, which is also a commission. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. The blessing is also a charge, and it echoes the blessings and the commission originally given to humanity in the garden. To be fruitful and fill the earth, to compassionately rule over creation, and to cultivate the garden of creation. Genesis chapter 1, verses 27 through 31, and chapter 2, verse 15. The ending of Christian worship, then, is a sending. Having encountered God in word and sacrament, we are transformed and renewed, and empowered by the Spirit to take up once again the original vocation of humanity, to be God's image bearers by cultivating all the possibilities latent in God's creation, now renewing and restoring a broken, fallen world. Drawn into union with Christ, the end of Christian worship is bound up with our sending for Christian action, rightly ordered cultural labor, the creational task of making and remaking God's world. We are remade to be makers. This is why I believe the mission and task of the Christian university are bound up with the practices of Christian worship. While the Christian university and the church are different institutions, they have the same end, the same goal: to draw the people of God into union with Christ in order to thereby shape, form, equip, and prime actors, doers of the word. So a robust account of Christian education and formation requires an adequate philosophy of action, something little thought about in contemporary discussions that are fixated on the Christian mind. We have spent a generation thinking about thinking. But despite our folk accounts and deluded self-perception, we don't think our way through to action. Much of our action is not the outcome of rational deliberation and conscious choice. Much of our action is not pushed by ideas or conclusions. Rather, it grows out of our character and is, in a sense, pulled out of us by our attraction to a telos. If we, and if the alumni of Christian universities, are going to be prime citizens of the kingdom of God, who act in the world as agents of renewal and redemptive culture making, then it is not enough to equip our intellects to merely think rightly about the world. We also need to recruit our imaginations. Our hearts need to be captured by a vision of a telos that pulls out of us action that is directed toward the kingdom of God. That is why, in Desiring the Kingdom, I argued that providing people with a Christian worldview is inadequate for the mission of both the church and the Christian university. The argument is not that worldview approaches and intellectual reflection are wrong, but only that they are inadequate, and this inadequacy stems from the stunted anthropology they assume. Such a picture of education is insufficiently radical because it doesn't get to the root of our identity. By fixating on the intellectual aspect, such a model of the person and its corresponding picture of education undervalues and underestimates the importance of the affective. By focusing on what we think and believe, such a model misses the centrality and primacy
of what we love. By focusing on education as the dissemination of information, we have missed the ways in which Christian education is really a project of formation. In other words, at the heart of the argument is an anti-reductionism and the affirmation of a more holistic understanding of human persons and Christian education, and Christian formation more broadly. Thus, I make three intertwined proposals in Desiring the Kingdom that are at the heart of the Cultural Liturgies Project and are all indebted to Saint Augustine, that patron saint of the Reformers. First, I sketch an alternative anthropology that emphasizes the primacy of love and the priority of the imagination in shaping our identity and governing our orientation to the world. Second, I emphasize that education is also about the formation or aiming of our love and desire, and that such formation happens through embodied communal rituals we might call liturgies, including a range of secular liturgies that are pedagogies of desire. Third, given the formative priority of liturgical practices, I argue that the task of Christian education needs to be resituated within the ecclesial practices of Christian worship and liturgical formation. In other words, we need to reconnect worship and worldview, church and college. To be very clear, this does not constitute a rejection of worldview per se. Think of my argument as two cheers for this paradigm. However, I think there remain legitimate concerns with even the best rendition of worldview approaches, insofar as these approaches tend to still conceive the task of Christian education as the dissemination of a perspective, a way to see the world. My criticism here is not that worldview is wrong, but only that it is inadequate. It is an approach that imagines us and our students as primarily spectators of the world rather than as actors in the world. But if one of the goals of Christian education is to form what Neil Plantinga describes as prime citizens of the kingdom, then we need to appreciate that our actions as citizens are based not primarily on cognitive deliberation or even on our perspectives, but for the most part on acquired habits, unconscious desires, and pre-intellectual dispositions. And so our education has to be attuned to how those desires and dispositions are formed. We might have a highly developed articulate worldview and yet act in ways that are remarkably inconsistent with such a perspective. To think about. Longing leads to action. Action and creative cultural labor are generated more by visions than maxims, more by a telos than a rule. This intuition is captured in a saying attributed to Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, the author of The Little Prince. If you want to build a ship, don't drum up people to collect wood, and don't assign them tasks and work, but rather teach them to long for the endless immensity of the sea. Picturing the limitations of worldview. Reading Wendell Berry in Costco. Let me try to make sense of this with an example. Over the past several years, through the steady evangelism of my wife, Deanna, I have become more and more convinced about the injustice and unhealthiness of our dominant systems of food production and consumption. For Deanna, this is expressed in a commitment to good eating, eating that is both healthy and just, enjoying foods that are the fruit of local gardens and farms, and eating foods that contribute to our flourishing. This finds expression both in her devotion to her gardens and her recruitment of the entire family in a kitchen that is always producing culinary delights, for which I'm incredibly grateful, and through the influence of authors like Barbara Kingsolver, Michael Pollan, and especially Wendell Berry, I have become intellectually convinced that they offer the best perspective for thinking about these issues. Indeed, in many ways, I've tried to own their perspective as my own. But a funny thing happened on the way to the grocery store. I discovered a significant gap between my thought and my action. This hit home to me one day while I was immersed in reading Wendell Berry's delightful anthology, Bringing It to the Table. As I paused to reflect on a key point and thus briefly took my nose out of the book, I was suddenly struck by an ugly irony. Here I was reading Wendell Berry in the food court at Costco.
There are so many things wrong with that sentence that I don't even know where to begin. Indeed, the food court at Costco might be a kind of shorthand for Barry's picture of the sixth circle of hell. So how might one account for this gap between my thought and my action, between my passionate intellectual assent to these ideas and my status quo action? Why do I believe Michael Pollan but still pull into the drive-thru at McDonald's? This is exactly the intuition at the heart of this book. While Pollan and Barry may have successfully recruited my intellect, they have not been successful in converting my habits. Nor could they be, for so much of my action in and orientation to the world is governed by dispositions that are shaped by practice. Implicit in the anthropology of desiring the kingdom is a philosophy of action, a tacit assumption about what drives or causes human behavior and action. And such a philosophy of action is germane to the goal and task of both Christian education and Christian formation more broadly. Such an account of the formative power of both secular liturgies and intentional Christian worship has a certain urgency precisely because it assumes that so much of our orientation to and action in the world is governed by preconscious habits and patterns of behavior, and those habits are formed by environments of practice. This stands in contrast to what Charles Taylor calls intellectualist or decisionist models, which tend to overestimate thinking as the cause of action. This does not entail a crass determinism, nor does it exclude a role for reflective, deliberative, conscious choice. However, such a model, shored up by recent research in cognitive science, does relativize the role of ratiocinative deliberation in action. More positively, it highlights the significant impact of environment and attendant practices in shaping our adaptive unconscious, which then steers, drives action at a preconscious level. As such, we should be increasingly attentive to the formative role of environment and practice in shaping our desires, while also recognizing our habitual orientation to the world that undergirds so much of our action. The response to such a situation is not simply pressing people to think more about what they're doing. If I am intellectually convinced by Michael Pollan, but still have the default disposition to pull into the drive-thru at McDonald's, the solution is not to be constantly thinking. That approach is unsustainable and thus ultimately inadequate. It's not a matter of thinking trumping dispositions, it's a matter of acquiring new habits. This can be illustrated with a related example from practices associated with food and eating. In his book Mindless Eating, Cornell nutritionist Brian Wansink accounts for the American obesity epidemic in terms of the habits and practices that unconsciously shape our tastes and eating patterns. We are trained to orient ourselves to food and food systems by practices and environments that shape our orientation at a preconscious level. And then we regularly act on the basis of those malformed desires and deep-seated habits. We eat mindlessly in the sense that we eat without thinking about it. So one might guess that the solution to this problem is to acquire knowledge, to encourage critical thinking so that reason trumps desire and so that critical reflection trumps unreflective habits. But that's not Wansink's antidote. In fact, he explicitly argues that the solution is not just a matter of mindful eating. Thinking about it will always be inadequate, like reading Wendell Berry in Costco, simply because so much of our action is not the outcome of a conscious, deliberative thought process. Drawing on extensive psychological research, Wansink demonstrates that we simply are not the sorts of animals who can be deliberatively on all the time. So the proper response to unhealthy mindless eating is not mindful eating, but rather healthy mindless eating, changing environments and practices in order to form different unconscious habits. This doesn't mean there is no role for critical reflection. Indeed, Wansink offers an argument to press people to change their practices, and that approach is only going to work if they are, to some degree, convinced by his argument. But the upshot or consequence is not that they will then think about every meal, but rather that they will be propelled to change their environment and practices, thereby absorbing different habits and undoing old ones.
As a result, even their mindless eating will be healthy. They will eat well and justly, without thinking about it, though if you ask them, they can articulate why. Their new eating habits will have become second nature. A worldview approach would assume that the proper response to disordered mindless eating is mindful eating, as if simply getting the right perspective on eating is sufficient. Similarly, an intellectualist model of education would assume that the proper response to the unconscious formation of secular liturgies would be critical reflection, thinking about it more, thinking about what we are doing. Of course, such reflection and thinking are important and helpful. Indeed, as Wansink would note, reflection is precisely what might lead us to immerse ourselves in different environments and commit ourselves to different practices, with the goal of ultimately acquiring different habits and dispositions. Similarly, the articulation of a Christian worldview is helpful, just as thinking about practices can be a reflective opportunity to take stock of our routines and rituals. Indeed, the entire Cultural Liturgies project is itself an invitation to reflect on our practices, to gain a Christian perspective on our immersion in cultural practices. The argument of desiring the kingdom is not that we need less than worldview, but more. Christian education will only be fully an education to the extent that it is also a formation of our habits. And such formation happens not only, or even primarily, by equipping the intellect, but through the repetitive formation of embodied, communal practices. And the core of those formative practices is centered in the practices of Christian worship. Situating intellect, educating for action. The liturgical anthropology at the heart of my project entails a critique of worldview because it relativizes thinking and resituates intellect. But the critique of worldview talk is not a critique of worldview per se, nor is it a rejection of thinking per se. The point, rather, is that we have a tendency in Christian higher education, and even in the church, to overestimate the importance of thinking. Now, many of those toiling in the not-so-ivory halls of Christian colleges and universities would be quite surprised to hear that thinking is being overvalued in North American Christianity. Indeed, quite the opposite seems to be true. Evangelical piety tends to intensify a general anti-intellectual malaise that besets our culture. The response to such a situation would be to encourage more thinking, not less. To emphasize the importance of the mind, rather than fall back into the soppy mushiness of the heart and its affections. In short, with its critique of rationalist or intellectualist models of the human person, it would seem that desiring the kingdom plays right into the hands of anti-intellectualism. Indeed, some seem to worry that my model would simply have us spending all day in chapel or turning the Christian college into a glorified Sunday school. But such worries stem from a misunderstanding of my emphasis on worship with respect to worldview. In particular, such a worry seems to read my claim that worship is a necessary and important condition for integral Christian education as if I were claiming that it is a sufficient condition for Christian education. And this includes Christian education in the wider sense of discipleship, even though my focus tends to be on Christian higher education. But I'm not suggesting we raise the physics lab and expand the chapel. I'm not suggesting we demolish the literature classroom and just stay in church all week. Nor do I anywhere suggest that a Christian university is not about the business of ideas. Of course it is. The issue is whether it is just trafficking in ideas. It's the latter that I'm rejecting. Let's remember the heart of the argument here. Because we are liturgical animals who are defined by what we love, and because our loves and desires are primed and shaped by formative practices, then a holistic model of Christian education, whether in the church, school, or university, needs to involve a pedagogy of desire. Such a pedagogy is not merely a conduit for disseminating information. A pedagogy of desire is a strategy for formation. Christian education in this model is not merely about dispensing Christian ideas or providing Christian perspectives. It is more invasive than that, precisely because it is not just an education for observers or spectators. It should be an education for actors,
for doers. A Christian education cannot be content to produce thinkers. It should aim to produce agents. Such formation not only offers content for minds, it also impinges on the nexus of habits and desires that functions as the activity center of the human person. The driving center of human action and behavior is a nexus of loves, longings, and habits that hums along under the hood, so to speak, without needing to be thought about. These loves, longings, and habits orient and propel our being in the world. The focus on formation is holistic because its end is Christian action. What's at stake here is not just how we think about the world, but how we inhabit the world, how we act. We are what we love precisely because we do what we love. It is this ultimate goal of shaping actors that creates misunderstandings. Reflecting the thinking thing-ism of modernity, many models of Christian higher education and many accounts of discipleship are fixated on epistemic matters. Seeing Christianity as primarily a set of doctrines, beliefs, and ideas, they implicitly and functionally reduce Christian education to the acquisition of knowledge. They also tend to assume a stunted, misguided philosophy of action that mistakenly sees action as the outcome of rational deliberation. Hence, most Christian accounts of education and pedagogy end up being covert epistemologies focused on what and how we know. But as I already sketched in Desiring the Kingdom, this is both a dated account of human action and a rationalistic reduction of Christian faith. Because my primary concern is not merely an epistemology, but also a philosophy of action, critics react to the decentralization and relativization of knowing in my account as if this entailed a rejection of knowledge. But the goal is not to denigrate the intellect. Rather, it is to situate theoretical reflection within the wider purview of our fundamental pre-theoretical orientation to the world. On the basis of this, those who are fixated on an epistemic construal of Christian faith too hastily conclude that relativizing the intellect is somehow a rejection of the intellect, but that clearly doesn't follow. Rather, the project is to consider the significance of our non- and pre-intellectual orientation to the world, to appreciate all of the ways in which this shapes and governs our being in the world, and to therefore expand what we consider as falling within the purview of education. To situate and relativize the intellect is not anti-intellectual. It is to emphasize that even rationality needs to be faithful, needs to be disciplined and trained and habituated. Education operates on this pre-theoretical register whether we recognize it or not. Pedagogies of desire form our habits, affections, and imaginations, thus shaping and priming our very orientation to the world. So if a Christian education is going to be holistic and formative, it needs to attend to much more than the intellect, which is why I emphasize that there is a unique understanding that is carried in Christian practices, particularly the practices of Christian worship. It is in such practices that our love is trained, disciplined, shaped, and formed. And it is, to some extent, only in such practices that this can happen. Attention to intellect is insufficient precisely because there is an irreducible, unique understanding that is only carried in practices and only absorbed through our immersion over time in those practices. And it is this non-conscious understanding that drives our action. My focus is on this non-conscious understanding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.